Can you hear it? I can't hear a thing. Is it there? Okay. How's this one, Megan? This one okay? That good? How about this one, Megan? Is that one okay? Can you hear everything all right, Maggie? No, I can hear that, so you should be good. Are these two okay?
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning to you. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
Is this on? No? Have any sound? We don't need this. Here. Now I'll talk to you. Oh, first thing I have to do, I want to say good morning to you all. And I'd like to see a big smile from everybody. Look great. That's fantastic. Way to go. The new normal, as we call it now, next Sunday we'll be having communion. So here are a few things to follow. Number one, bring your own bread or cracker. That way we don't have to do all what we do before or what we did before. And something to drink. Let me rephrase that. Maybe a juice, or some water, something like that to celebrate. Just come prepared is all I can really tell you to do. Come prepared. The other thing is at the back of the church, there are collection plates, and at the front of the church, there are collection plates. And if you want to put your money in on the way in or on the way out, that's fine. I had a note from a lady by the name of Janice Noble. I think some of you know Janice. Janice is the new executive director of Camp Kidston. She's been involved with them now for about 3 years, and she's moved up, and now she's the head lady. On October the 24th, they're going to be doing their annual fix-up. So if you go to Camp Kidston, they're going to be doing painting, and they're going to be cutting down some trees and making all kinds of things. If you want to go, they will be providing a hot meal on that day. It's October the 24th, which is a Saturday. They will, if you're going to go, they'd like to... I'd like you to get in touch with them. So if you want to do that, just get in touch with me, and I will do that for you, set it all up for you. Next Tuesday, not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday, there will be a stewards meeting. The only reason I'm telling you now is because next week being Thanksgiving, not everybody's here. We're out partying or something like that. What you see up front here is an empty water container. If you recall, our Lenten project was to get a defibrillator for here. We currently have about $700 in that account, but kind of Lent's passed us or gone by there. So if you want to at any time make a donation towards the defibrillator, this will be here every Sunday, so we can use that. Okay? That's all I have. Thanks.
Thank you, Gary. So as we come in this time for worship, let us acknowledge place. As we gather to worship, let us pause to remember that in this region where we work and live and worship, we are on lands that are by law the unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. We are all treaty people. Umsit Nogma. May we live with respect on this land and live in peace and friendship with its people. As we light the Christ candle this morning, let us take this opportunity to remember the new creed. Remember what we I'll invite you to rise and say this together. this morning, instead of calling it a call to worship and an opening prayer, you'll see gathering words and gathering prayer. Let us join together in our gathering words. This morning, the sun's first rays called the day to light. Did you hear the chatter and songbirds breaking the silence of pre-dawn night? Did you see the colors of dawn stretched across the heavens? Did you feel the cool night air shifting to a morning breeze? Creation is stirring. Our day has begun. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Some of us woke from peaceful slumber, refreshed and renewed. Or perhaps it was a long, endless night of sleep-deprived hours, or even the tormented dreams of a restless mind. Yet we have gathered here. Whether reluctant or joyful, weary or rested, we raise our hearts in song and praise. Holy, 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 Lord God, early in the morning, our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Let us pray together our gathering prayer. Actually, let me pray. You pray in silence. Creating one, here we are, a gathering of your people, evidence of creation's unfolding. We come, all shapes and all sizes, all ages and life stages. We come on dancing feet or carefully walking. We come hesitant and unsure, or filled with conviction and knowing our way. However we come, we are here to join with all of creation in praise and thanksgiving. Accept our gift of worship as with one heart, one home, one love, we gather into praise. Our opening hymn is sung to us this morning by the Woodlawn United Church Girls Choir alumni, directed by June Rigdon. Look carefully for someone you know. Thank you. 25 years. And our
reflective reading. It's called The Storms, Clouds, Gathering. Okay. In the middle weeks of July, in the midst of heat wave, when temperatures soared, humidity gathered, and the songs of Sagaeus seized through, endless hot nights, plants and people and animals and insects wilted. The air was without breath of breeze, oppressive, still. In that moment, clouds gathered on the horizon, dark and ominous in the still summer air. A slight current stirred. The darkness of the sky stretched over the land. Winds grew in ferocity, trees bent to the earth, branches withered and twisted. The air became a cacophony of rushing sound as the rain hit, pounding against the earth, driving against the fields, drowning the world in the white noise. Life twisted, branches torn, trees shattered abruptly, wind faded, rain eased, clouds scattered into silence. In the storm-bruised rural, the litter of the broken leaves, the debris of branches scattered, the chaos of trees uprooted. Devastated lives, devastated hearts. Stripped of sound and fury, the air was clear and cool, still and silent. Into the silence came the booming drumbeat of our neighborhood bullfrog, speaking reassurance from the roadside ditch. Gently came the first call of a killdeer and the mutest sounds, sigh of mourning doves.
and after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard that, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Here ends our reading. Please pray with me. Dear God, may the words that I share reach hearts that need to hear them. May the thoughts I share inspire us all to think on you. And may all of us feel your presence here. And may each of us take a moment this day to love you. Amen. So perhaps you got to experience some of that warm but very strong autumn wind that we had this week, did you? When was the last time, if that wasn't this week, when was the last time that you really stood in the power of the wind? Standing at the top of a tall building, maybe, or maybe at a lighthouse. We are blessed and cursed with a heck of a lot of wind here in Nova Scotia. It is so often a force to be reckoned with, isn't it? So we have taken advantage of the good power as a natural resource. More and more windmills, regardless of how you feel about them, are popping up to harness the wind and make a cleaner energy. Or what about this? Do any of you sail? Anybody sail? Oh, we'll skip that analogy then. But isn't it amazing how the same wind that powers windmills and the same wind that goes into sails, pushing boats along, that same wind that goes into the grid that powers our homes is the same wind that knocks down power lines and throws trees into houses, taking away that very power. Can we be grateful for the wind and all the things that it represents? In today's reading, Elijah was waiting for God to pass by, but did you hear God had said, "Go outside, Elijah, stand and wait, for the Lord is about to pass by." But did you hear at the end of the reading? Once it was quiet, he put on his mantle and went outside. He didn't go before then. Did you notice that? You know when I noticed it? Just now. That's not in my sermon today. It's funny. You can read scripture again and again and again and latch on to different parts. But I thought, he didn't even go outside until the wind and the earthquake and the fire had stopped. Elijah didn't expect to hear God in the wind and in the storm. But he did hear it in the calm after it. I wonder why, though, the writer bothers to tell us about all the places where the Lord was not. Not in the great wind, not in the earthquake, not in the fire. But I wonder, maybe the Lord really was there. Maybe it was Elijah didn't hear it or feel the Lord until it was calm enough for him to hear God's voice. Perhaps Elijah really needed the chaos to first sort out for him what God was really asking of him. Because you did notice maybe that God asked him exactly the same question before the storm as he did after the storm. What did he say? He said, "Elijah, oh, we've been apart a long time. You guys forgot that this is a conversation. I am not here for your entertainment. Let's engage. Do you remember?" He said, "Elijah, what are you doing here?" He said that. What are you doing here? And I think that God is still asking that question of us. Church, what are you doing here? It is the chaos and the calm of creation that keeps pushing and pulling us, especially in these COVID times, to think about that deep question. What are we doing here?
I was listening on my way in to a podcast with Brené Brown and David Kessler, an expert on grief. And she asked him, like, what is it that we're experiencing right now? And David Kessler, the expert on grief, said, we are experiencing the collective loss of the world as we knew it. You feel that? We are experiencing the collective loss of the world as we knew it. The world will never be the same. Just like after 9/11, there's going to be a time when we say, remember what it was like before the pandemic? That's where we are. And what happens when you are in grief? I totally went off script, but what happens? We've got to get back. What happens when you're in grief? Are you the most pleasant person to be around? Thank you for shaking your head, because I can't see anybody. I don't know if you're answering me or not. Amanda's like, no. No. Another writer, actually another person that she interviewed, I listen to her in the car all the time. She interviewed Bishop Michael Curry. You know Bishop Michael Curry? He was, you'll know when I say it, who watched the royal wedding? Yeah, he was the African-American preacher that preached at the wedding. He is the bishop of the Episcopalian, which is the Anglican church in the U.S. So she had Michael Curry on there, and he said, we are all on edge. And he said, I've even had to say to my people, careful where you step right now. We're all on the edge. Even me, is what he says. Even me. We need to be kinder with each other. We need to be more gentle with each other. And we have to take that question of, why are we here, a little more seriously. When our lives have been flipped upside down, whether because of natural and COVID-19, I hate to tell you it's natural, or health disasters in our own personal lives, how do we find calm in the center of that chaos? How do we hear God's voice calling us to love one another and love all of creation? The writer of today's liturgy, Pat Milliken, she says this, to truly love creation requires us to listen to all of creation. The powerful storms and their stark beauty that reshape the landscape and destroy life, as well as the gentle beauty of birdsong or the preposterous thump of a bullfrog's call. The challenge of loving creation may be a reminder that the coyote and the wolf are as worthy of space on this earth as the Bambi and his friends. It's easier to appreciate God and have faith when life is easy. This morning I said to someone, isn't it a beautiful day? And they said, yes, this is the day that God has made. Do you ever say, this is the day that God has made when it's crap outside? Not often. It's so much harder to listen for God when life is falling apart, isn't it? It is easier to love creation when it's soft and cuddly or classically beautiful, or smells incredible. What does it mean to love creation when it is ugly and bites us? Or it's creepy and crawly? Or when it stinks like a dead body? There's a plant that stinks like that. Ugh. What if we sang hymns of praise to God for the awful stuff? It might sound a little something like this. One more time.
Little.
people singing, you wonder? But truth in that, isn't there? There's truth in that. So some of those things, if there are some scary things, really scary things. Snakes alone, not for me, but for a lot. Fire. Cancer. Viruses. What are the things that scare you about nature? There is a power in naming these things, giving thanks for them in the lessons that they teach us about the world, about ourselves, or even about the nature of God. Today, I think the lesson is that God is in all things, and each of us will find God when we need God the most. Some of us will find God in the wind, in the earthquake, in the fire, in the storm, in the lightning, in the thunder, you know, in the chaos. Others will find God once the storm is over, in the sunshine, and in the quiet, in the rainbow, and in the calm. We must always remember that whatever side of nature's delicate balance that we lean on, there is no rainbow without the rain. There is no calm without the chaos. And our job is to find our place in all of it. To find where we belong in God's creation. That involves recognizing the gifts and wisdom of God in all of it. And I think that is what it means to really love creation. If we treated creation like God was in all of it, can you imagine a love like that? So as we worship this day, let us consider what loving creation might look for us as individuals, but also as a church. What have we learned about creation and our relationship to it in the last 6 months? What has self-isolation and quarantine and all of this taught us about what it really means to say to yourself, why am I here? What has all of this taught us really matters to us. When we listen for God's voice and we hear that question, why are you here, Norval? Why are you here, Maggie? Why are you here, Al? When we hear that question, what answer do we hear? Is it different from what we thought we heard 6 months ago? Than it is in this current storm that we are still in. Make no mistake. I know this church has a history of starting projects with the environment in mind. One such project was the recycling project, a project that one of your most beloved members who died recently, dear Edna DeMann, I learned was super passionate about. What are you passionate about? Especially when it comes to the environment, what would you like to contribute to the life and the work of this church that says to God and this community, we care about creation, we love you. I'd love to connect with you and then connect you to the people and the places and the resources that you would need to make that kind of project happen. So as your minister, I am called to facilitate your ministry. This is not the ministry of Kim Curlett. This is the ministry of Riverview United Church. And as your ministry, I come in and I help you with whatever you decide your ministry is. So I look forward as we keep moving together in this, now that we're back together and I'm not alone in my living room, that we can work on this together. So if you have those ideas, send them to me, send them to the executive board, and let's see what we can do together, shall we? May it be so. I'm going to invite you to stand now, and we're going to read part of, and thankfully only part of, to read the whole thing takes about 15 minutes. We're not going to do that. We're going to read part of one of the four doctrinal statements of the United Church of Canada. We already read one this morning. Do you know what it was? The Creed. Yeah, a new creed, 1968, but still new. It's like we call the new bridge, around the same time period. This is a song of creation. It's actually newer. It's 2006. And this is just a part of it. You can find the whole of it on the United Church of Canada website. It's a beautiful doctrinal statement from the United Church of Canada. So let's stand and read it together. We witness to holy mystery that is holy love. God is creative and self-giving, generously moving in all the near and distant corners of the universe. Nothing exists that does not find its source in God. Our first response to God's providence is gratitude. We sing thanksgiving, finding ourselves in a world of beauty and mystery, of living things diverse and independent, of complex patterns of growth and evolution, of subatomic particles and cosmic swirls. We sing of God, the creator, the maker, and source of all that is. Each part of creation reveals unique aspects of God, the creator, who is both in creation and beyond it. All parts of creation, animate and inanimate, are related. All creation is good. We sing of the Creator who made humans to live and move and have their being in God. In and with God, we can direct our lives toward right relationship with each other and with God. We can discover our place as one strand in the web of life. We can grow in wisdom and compassion. We can recognize all people as kin. We can accept our mortality and finitude, not as a curse, but as choices matter. You may be seated. Our hymn for reflection is Bach's Prelude, number 1 in C major, played by Martha.
Thank you. God's people said, Amen. Thank you, Martha. It's our Minute for Mission video. So we'll make our way to that this morning. Get ready for a video, guys.
Dem am I garden mel. The canoe has to be uprated. That's what it means. The canoe has to be uprated after a mishap. So it's a metaphor of life. When you have mishaps in life or death, you have to rearrange and look forward and go forward from that mishap.
Oh, I miss the man. I knew Alvin for a long time, and I was ever so pleased when he came into the church and started working for the church and worked to better the situation for First Nations people in BC.
Well, Alvin and I go from way back. I started working with Alvin, you know, through the Native Ministry Council and through the years, and right up to his death we worked together both provincially and nationally at different gatherings. He did a lot of work through visiting different communities, you know, listening to them. And the national gatherings and provincial gatherings, he'd do the same. And using all what he learned and bringing it to a church house or to BC conference.
He's one of these guys that said it as it was. He sometimes wasn't very gentle, but was effective. He understood and knows traditionally who he was, and he also has a teaching degree. And so you can say that he lived both worlds. And because of the fact that he lived both worlds, he had a good understanding of our situation as Native people. Well, I think it's a necessary thing, as long as it carries the message that it should. That we as people that try to lead in this United Church of Canada, to be involved in the church, do it in such a way and teach people that we need to take certain steps, important steps, to establish who we are, so that we are the church, and that has to continue.
The work that he did to, you know, for the Native congregations and non-Native congregations to be more closer, as I said earlier, to get that canoe going in the right direction and together. And he did a lot of work. Work of bringing people together, and to name it in his honor was the best way to show some, you know, to show respect and a big thank you for his work.
already donate to the work of the Mission and Service Fund of the United Church of Canada, we thank you. If you don't yet, we ask you to consider it in your weekly offering. So we don't have a time when we officially take up collection anymore. There is a collection plate at the back. There is one at the front here. So depending on which direction you leave, either through the doors there or out the side, maybe one of our folks will be able to move the collection plate over by the other door at the end. And so we thank you for all of the ways that you've been able to donate financially to the work and life of this church, either by a paper donation here, through PAR, by email money transfer, through Canada Donates, and all of the ways are listed on our website at elmsdalecooperativeministry.com under donations. So thank you for these things. We are gifted by a world that delights and astonishes us, frightens and informs us, provides all that we need and more than we should possibly want. From the abundance we have received, we give our gifts of thanksgiving. Let's rise for our offering hymn. If you like to boogie, now is the time. If you're like, that is really uncomfortable, then you just stand as you're able and enjoy the music, and it's a chance to get up and down in worship, which we do when we sing, but if you were just sitting here for the entire time, you would have very sore bottoms. So let's be grateful for that and stand up and listen to God of all the world.
God of all the world, we have come to give you thanks and become more like you. God of all the world, we have come to give you thanks and become more like you. In worship we long to be one with each other and you. God of all the world, we have come to give you thanks and become more like you. God of all the world, we have come to give you thanks and become more like you. In worship we long to be one with each other and you.
Remain standing as we pray. Creating God, with these gifts, we say thank you for all of creation. From ugly toads to gracious butterflies, from startling storms to star-filled nights, we are grateful to be a part of all that is. Holy One, whose breath is our life, whose grace is our hope, receive these gifts we offer. Bless them that they may be lived out, a faith lived out, hope lived, and love given for this world. All God's people said, Amen. Please be seated. So I'll take a deep breath and prepare ourselves for our prayer of the day. Holy One, breath of creation, stir in us. Open our hearts that we may see all of creation's glory. Open our hearts that we may know life is holy. Open our hearts that we may love with wonder and awe and reverence. Creating One, we understand that we live within creation, all woven together by the sacred breath of life. We confess the times we have chosen to forget. We name to you our careless greed when habitat has been denied, when invasive species have been introduced, when thoughtless destruction has been allowed, even encouraged. We name to you the flight of barn swallows, the thump of bullfrogs, the discreet beauty of the painted turtle, the majesty of elm trees, the upright strength of the ash, all of your creation that is diminished and threatened by our disinterest, by our complacent greed. Forgive us. Help us to discover the second chance of a growing awareness, a deepening understanding, an active love. May we live wisely with reverence for creation. May we live gently on this earth, giving room, sharing space, providing for all. We celebrate the steps taken to redeem this earth, the tall grass prairie replanted, the wild turkeys returned, groves of trees reestablished. Bless us as we better love your creation. To you we give our praise and thanksgiving for all that delights, for all that teaches, for all that is wondrous, for all of creation. Thank you. In this moment of silence, let us add our individual prayers to that collective thanks. Creating God, we offer our prayers for humanity, for broken hearts and wounded spirits, for moments requiring strength and courage. For our daily needs, we pray in silence. Holy One, we gather all of our prayers into one by praying together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from a time of trial. Deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I'll invite you to stand for the closing hymn that we move to but do not sing. Feel free to say the words you see on the screen, but no singing allowed just yet. It's a song of praise to the Maker. More Voices, number 30.
A song of praise to the Maker. The thrush sings high in the tree. It's a song of praise to the Maker. The gray whale sings in the sea. And by the Spirit, you of all creation.
sung by all living things. It's the chorus of all creation, a song that you never sing. And by the Spirit, you and I can join a voice to the holy cry and sing, sing, sing to the Maker.
Commissioning. Let's say together, with loving hearts and hands willing to serve, we go into this world, singing with creation and loving the earth even more deeply. And may God's perfect word revive your soul. May Christ Jesus be your Savior and your rock. And may the Holy Spirit strengthen you to press ever onward. The peace of Christ be with you. So we extinguish our candle as we do each week. On your way out, last week I just noticed, just want to put this out there, there was kind of this, we kind of reverted to the old way of being, doing things, and we gravitated towards each other. Remember to maintain your social distancing. As you leave, you also have to leave. when I was a bartender, I used to say, what did I used to say? Well, first I said, it's closing time. And then I said, you can keep talking, but you can't stay here, right? So out in the parking lot, be free to say to each other, peace of Christ be with you, right? You can still say that. I want to do one more thing before I turn the candle out, put it out, whatever you do to it. Take your arm, your right arm, wrap it around your body, like really like far around. Take your left arm and wrap it around your body. Okay, turn to somebody in here. Okay, you got your eyes on somebody? Get your eyes on somebody. Everybody get their eyes on somebody? Okay, Debbie, you need. There you go. Squeeze and feel them hugging you. I miss you so much. Oh. And we can pretend. But it does feel good, doesn't it? A little radical self-love today in the name of each other. So we will put out our candle as we recognize that this time of worship is over. Our time of service in the world starts now. Go in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.